Our plenary this year is a fascinating woman, Tomomi Kumai. She's a Korean-Japanese intercultural trainer whose work serves expats, international students, and nationals in the US, Korea, and Japan. She works with universities in Japan and Korea, as well as multinational corporations in various fields. Her work stems from a lifelong interest in communicating with people from different backgrounds. Her presentation is titled, Creating a Safe Space for Transformation. She says language education takes place in the context of culture. Language educators do not only support learners to achieve linguistic competence, but also intercultural competence to communicate effectively and appropriately in a different cultural context. In order to nurture this, a safe space is needed to allow open sharing and learning. She hopes at the end of the session, participants will be more aware of their cultural influences in their instructions and communication styles, which will enable them to create a safe space for their learners to become more conscious of their own cultural patterns and be able to express themselves more freely and effectively. So without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce Tomomi Kumai.
My name is Tomomi. I'm very honored to be here as a plenary for COTESOL 2020 conference, and I would like to deliver gratitude for the organizers who invited me. I live in Korea and I am working as an intercultural coach who provides intercultural training programs and coaching programs, mainly to Western expats people who come from North America or European countries to work with Korean nationals, or sometimes I do work in Japan too. I am 1/4 Japanese and 3/4 Korean. I was born and raised in Hiroshima, Japan. My mother is 100% Korean, who has Korean passport, and my dad is half Korean, half Japanese, who has Japanese passport. So in my household, there are a lot of Korean culture, which I didn't know until I grew up compared with my Japanese friends, and I found that it was different. So I grew up very bicultural household. I didn't know that other Japanese people didn't eat kimchi regularly, just like my family did. Back then, when I was small, Korean culture wasn't that popular in Japan, so there was a really big gap. Anyway, I grew up in a bicultural family until high school, and for the first year of my high school, I went to Hawaii to study English for 9 months. The reason I went there was because I was inspired by Hollywood movies, and I wanted to go to America to study English. But when I went to Hawaii, it was different from Hollywood movie depiction of American culture, because Hawaii was very multicultural. There I experienced something that I never experienced. And I came back to Japan and I finished my high school, and my next dream was to go to college in the States. So I went to San Diego State to get my degree in linguistics. And that was another multicultural experience for me, because I wasn't able to meet people from Mexico. My first roommate was Mexican American. And also I had a lot of friends who are Asian American. So I learned about the experience of being Asian American in the States, being a minority. Then after that, I worked in Japan and I went to Korea to study my heritage language. I also went to China to teach Japanese to Korean Chinese people. And there too, I experienced a lot of bilingualism and biculturalism. Then I went to University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign to get my master's degree in linguistics. So just like this, my background is all about learning and teaching languages, studying linguistics, and living and working in different cultures. So I am really happy that I am doing this work as an intercultural coach to support people who are studying, living, or working in a foreign country. So I am bridging the cultures between Western countries and East Asian, Japanese, and Korean cultures. My mission, my keywords for my mission is connect, learn, empower. My purpose is to provide time and space for people to connect with and learn from each other and empower each other. So I hope that today's session will be such a session that I'm going to be virtually connecting with you and we are learning from each other. Although this is one-way online session, I would appreciate your replies or emails or comments after this, so that I can learn from you also. And by doing this, I would like us to empower each other. And also, I would like to thank you for your work, because I know that I'm here to be able to give this talk because I learned English. I appreciate all the teachers and people who supported my language journey. And it's not just language. I didn't just learn the language, but I learned about the way to look at life or how to live my life by learning different languages. Because of learning different languages, my view and my beliefs of the world got broadened, and I can make better choices in my life. So foreign language learning journey was very transformative for me. So I would really want to thank all the language teachers that you're doing an amazing job, and you're touching every student's life to transform themselves. So today, why are we here? Because we want to create a safe space for students' transformation. Or it could be your transformation also. And how can a transformation happen? In order for a transformation to happen, it has to be a safe place for someone to be able to really be themselves. And in order to be themselves, in order to feel that they're accepted, then we need to make sure that we include different beliefs and different values. So I would like to propose that having cultural awareness is very important in the language learning setting, because usually in a language learning setting, we have different cultures together, working together. By having more awareness of the differences and respecting the differences, we can create a safe place. So by doing this plenary today, I would like both the teachers and learners to have more awareness on their cultures or other people's cultures. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to share personal experience as an intercultural coach and also as a language teacher and a learner. Secondly, I would like to introduce some intercultural models that will help you visualize what could be happening between different cultures. And lastly, I would like to provide some space and time for you to think how you can apply in your teaching or learning situation. Okay, so first of all, I would like to know about your teaching or learning experience. I wish that it was a very interactive session, but actually it's not. So I would appreciate it if you could ask yourself. So my first question is, how much cultural awareness do you have when you teach? On a scale of 1 to 10, can you give a number? 1, having no cultural awareness at all, or 10, always having cultural awareness when you teach, okay? And next question is, how much cultural awareness do your students have when they learn? Again, 1 is not having cultural awareness at all, or you don't know at all, to 10, always having cultural awareness. So based on your own rating, I hope that after this session that maybe you will have a little bit more awareness from next teaching or learning session. So before I go into introducing different models, but I would like to give 2 different definitions for this session. 1 is by Hofstede. The definition is, it's the collective programming of the mind distinguishing the members of one group or category of people from others. Here it says programming of the mind. That's the key point, I think, because you're so programmed that whatever the response or reaction is very automatic. If some stimulus comes, then you automatically respond or react without sometimes knowing it. That's why having the awareness is important. And also another important part is one group or a category of people. Here, it doesn't say it's necessarily a country culture. We don't have to define the culture by country names. Next definition is by Bennett. It's the learned and shared patterns of beliefs, behaviors, and values of groups of interacting people. So what it means is it's learned and shared. So what that means is you can unlearn and relearn. So again, I wanted to bring this definition because today the focus is raising awareness. By being aware of what is my learned beliefs or behaviors or values, then we can be able to adapt, or we can be able to respect different beliefs, behaviors, or values. And next thing I would like to introduce is called intercultural competence. What it is the ability to work or communicate effectively and appropriately with people from different cultures. So what does effectively mean? Effectively means if you have a purpose of doing something, if you have a goal of doing something, you will be able to finish it. You will be able to deliver it until the end. And in order to do that, you will need to use cognitive, affective, and behavioral skills. So easily put, you need to think and feel and behave effectively and appropriately. If you can do this, you will be able to reach the goal that you set. The project that you are going to work with different people, will be successfully accomplished. Sometimes, because of the lack of cognitive, affective, or behavioral skills in order to communicate effectively and appropriately, people misunderstand each other and people do not respect each other. The mistrust will increase so that the project cannot be done collaboratively and it might not be accomplished. But today, we will learn about intercultural competence and how we can do that so that we can increase our intercultural competence, or we can teach students about intercultural competence. And one of the models I would like to introduce is this iceberg of culture model. So what it means is that culture is like an iceberg. So you have a tip of iceberg where you can see and the bottom of the iceberg. Scientifically, it is said that you can only see 10% of the iceberg and the rest of it, 90%, is not visible. So then what does it mean when we apply it to culture? That means the top where we can see is usually something like behavior or something we can see. For example, if we talk about, okay, Korean culture, then people think about, okay, bibimbap, kimbap, something like food, or costumes, like hanbok, or music, K-pop, BTS. So these are the parts that people usually see and understand as culture. But as the iceberg's bottom part, those are the part where we cannot see. So what is it in culture? It's usually perceptions or attitudes or beliefs or values. For example, notions of good teacher. What does that mean in Korean culture? Who is a good teacher in Korean culture? Whereas, who is a good teacher in American culture? And next example is attitudes towards mistakes. Maybe this is an important part in language teaching, language learning. How do people perceive mistakes? Is it something to hide? Or is it something to appreciate and work on to get better? It can affect language learning, but it's not written or it's not shown. So you can only see the difference from interactions. And other areas that maybe we can think about is teacher-learner relationship. What kind of relationship is more appreciated in Korean culture? And what kind of teacher-learner relationship is appreciated in your culture? We have rules of hierarchy. Okay, do you have really strict rules for hierarchy? Do you have higher power distance or power distance is close? Like, do you have egalitarian? And the concept or use of time. Depending on the culture, use of time can be different. For example, Korea has pali-pali culture. They want to do it quickly. Maybe sometimes doing it faster with 70% completion is better than doing it at slower rate with 100% completion. So it depends on what each culture values. But again, those are at the bottom of the iceberg, so it's not written and we don't see it. We only learn about it when we actually experience it by working with people who have different values. And another concept I would like to introduce when we talk about culture is cultural onion. It's said that culture is like onion. It means it has a lot of layers of diversity. When we talk about the Korean culture, that doesn't mean all the Korean people, all the Korean culture is homogenous and the same. So layers of diversity starts with the core, which is personality. Each individual has personality. And the next dimension is called internal dimension. Internal dimension includes factors such as age, gender, sexual orientation, nationality, and ethnicity. Not only being Korean or being Filipino is all the identity, but also age, gender. So it means other than the ethnic culture, also there are age differences, generation differences. Even if you are the same citizens of the country, you can have cultural differences or you can have different perspectives and different beliefs if you are in different generations. And also sometimes being a male, being a female, gender can affect how you think. And sexual orientation. And then the next layer is called external dimensions. For example, it affects like income level, socioeconomic status, or educational background, or your work experience, what kind of work you have done. Also, marital status. Are you single? Are you married? Or are you divorced? These also create different layers of culture. And the very outside of the layer is called organizational dimensions. It can be a functional level, and next is work content or field. Even you're teaching English, which field you're from, maybe the way you teach or is different. Or maybe, you know, if you study applied linguistics or if you study theoretical linguistics, these cultures are different. Also, faculty or department can affect differently. It creates culture too. So if you're teaching English in business department or if you're teaching English in literature department, they have different cultures. And type of employment also is another layer. So are you a full-time teacher at a university or are you a part-time teacher at Hagwon? So there are so many different layers of diversity, and what who you are is made up with these layers, and who each student is has these layers. So we have to be aware of these layers when we talk about cultures. Next concept I would like to introduce you is stereotypes and generalizations. Maybe many of you are already familiar with these concepts, but I would like to talk about it because it's really important part of talking about culture. Generalization is usually non-judgmental and it allows individuality. So when you try to describe a group of people, then you need to still come up with something to describe them. So you will use neutral terms, which are not judgmental, and you can always update the definition when you find a new case or new samples. So what are stereotypes? Usually, stereotypes are very fixed or conventional, and it allows no individuality, and comments are usually critical, negative, or judgmental. For example, saying something like, the only thing Korean students worry about is test scores. So the words such as all or no or nothing, always, never is usually used when we stereotype some group of people. So we would want to be aware of ourselves when we start using these words. And also some critical words saying only care for this. But we still need to generalize a group of people when we talk about different culture or different group of people. And we can use non-judgmental, descriptive, neutral words, and we can allow individuality. We can admit that there are different people who have different views. So you can say, many of my Korean students in my class take TOEIC exams more than 3 times during semester. So as you can see, that saying something like, all the Korean students only care about TOEIC test results, versus many of my Korean students in my class take TOEIC exams as many as 3 times per semester, gives different notions. So what's happening when we were generalizing? So as you can see, this is a bell curve. So when we were generalizing, what we were talking about is usually average member of the culture. But still, the bell curve exists. So there are people who are on the both sides of the bell curve, which is considered to be atypical member of the curve. So we can think about it, you know, as a Japanese, as a Korean, as American, as a group member, are you a typical member of your culture? Am I a typical member of Japanese culture? Are you a typical member of British culture? And when there is two different cultures in a space, and when we were comparing or making generalizations, then there are two bell curves. For example, there is green bell curve and also red bell curve. And we can compare two different cultural values. So when we make generalization, as I said, we're talking about the average member of people. For example, when we compare Japanese and Korean culture, people say, okay, Japanese people are more strict about time and Koreans are a little bit laid back about time. And if you see strict and laid back, and here is the Japanese average, and here is Korean average. But of course, there are some Japanese people who are more laid back than average of Korean people. And of course, there are some Korean people who are more strict about time than average Japanese people. So when we talk about generalizations, we have to be aware that we are talking about at least these two different bell curves. And we're usually comparing the average of these two bell curves. Now I would like to introduce some of the cultural dimensions affects Korean culture more than other cultures. So first dimension is task-oriented or relationship-oriented. Korea is a very relationship-oriented culture. So more than just doing the task itself, it's really important to build personal relationship first in order to work together. If you come from very task-oriented culture where doing things or getting the thing done is more important, then relationship-oriented culture feel like, why are they wasting time just chit-chatting or wasting time drinking coffee? But in Korea, you need to get to know the person first in order to trust relationship. Because you build the trust, you feel that you can work with this person. So maybe taking out students for a coffee or lunch or dinner at the beginning of the semester when you get to know each other, maybe it's very effective. And if you cannot go outside of classroom, maybe just designating one session just to focus on getting to know each other might be a good idea, so that you will make a sense of a community so students will feel safer to talk more or work on English assignments. And the task-oriented culture, getting the thing done is very important. And personal life is something that you want to separate from what you're doing, what your business is. So maybe as an English teacher, focusing on teaching English and focusing on classroom activity is important. And maybe not so much of getting to know students too personally or having outside activities might not be your priority. But from relationship-oriented person, if they see individualistic, that maybe they will feel that this person doesn't care about them. So for task-oriented people, it's important that you have the ability to get the task done. And as long as you do it right, then you can build a trust. Then after you build a trust, you might want to get to know that person later. So depending on if you're task-oriented or relationship-oriented, maybe the order of what's happening when you build trust could be different. So you want to be aware that what your style is and what your students' styles are. The next is hierarchy. Do you have a really rigid hierarchy, or do you have more flat hierarchy, which is called egalitarian? Korea tend to have more hierarchy. As you might already know, age is the default hierarchy in Korea, and even they're in the same classroom, depending on how old you are, maybe within the students group there is hierarchy. Also, maybe which high school they came from, if they're university students, or which school they belong to, if they're Harvard students, maybe there's social hierarchy. And depending on the hierarchy, how they behave to each other, how they speak to each other can change. So that happens among the students, but also the relationship between the teacher and the students. Teacher is the one who's higher, and someone who's higher has more authority, more power, more knowledge. So students expect teacher to give instructions and which direction he or she wants the students to do, or what kind of answer the teacher is looking for is something that the students try to figure out, because it's not so much of what they think or what they want to do is important, but what the higher person wants is more important. Whereas egalitarian flat culture, there's not so much power distance between teacher and the students. I was really surprised when I went to San Diego State University. My professor said, "Oh, call me Julie." And so I wasn't calling her a professor or anything, but just by first name. And which shows that the egalitarian culture of the U.S. academic culture. And I know that on the West side, California culture and East Coast university cultures are also different. But compared to where I came from, where teachers are here very high and learners are here, I was very surprised that the power distance between the teacher and the learners are very close. This can influence the directions you want to give to the students. A lot of expat people say that in Korea, they feel like they have to micromanage the Korean team because they would like to just give the project because they are the ones who knows what to do, and it's a form of respect to let them do their way as long as you get the outcome result back. But a lot of times, Western managers are surprised at how Koreans want more details, how to do certain things or best practices. So it could be the same in the language learning also. Rather than giving the wanted outcome, maybe giving more detailed instruction will help them learn. This is like an example of how to play with Lego. Some people want to just given the instructions, they build a plane, and all they do is they build their own plane. But others, they want the manual. They want, okay, I want you to put these blocks together and next this block together and have the final product. So in a culture with higher hierarchy or more strict hierarchy, students tend to look for more detailed instruction from the teachers. And the last concept I would like to introduce is direct and indirect cultural dimensions. In some culture, saying what you mean and meaning what you say is very important, and you can be very straightforward and tell the other person what you think or what you want. Whereas in indirect cultures, especially some negative messages, you don't feel comfortable because you would like to keep harmony between among the group. People make it very indirect that they don't like something or they cannot do something. And this is the area that in my intercultural coaching that many expats people struggle working with Koreans. And this is related to also hierarchy and relationship orientation. Because there's hierarchy, people cannot tell to their boss or the teacher that they cannot do it, or they made a mistake, or they don't like it, in order to save face of someone that who they are supposed to show respect. So maybe in your classroom, students always smile at you and say yes, 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 but maybe some of the assignments are not done or not on time, and maybe they're struggling, but it's really difficult for you to know. So basically, in indirect communication, it's really difficult to say no. And instead of saying no, you might be able to find some signs. First of all, silence. You ask a question, there's a delay in reply. That means maybe they want to say no, but they don't want to say no. And the second is some sound like or hesitation. That means no is there, but they cannot say it. Another thing is, oh, that's difficult. Difficult sounds like it's challenging, but I can do it. But actually, it means it's difficult and maybe it's not possible. And next thing is, I'll do my best. That also sounds really positive, but actually what it means is, I'll do my best, but I cannot guarantee that I can do it. So you want to see these signs and find out how the students are feeling. I introduce you three major areas that many expat people feel that they're having difficulties when they're communicating or working with Koreans. So I hope that you feel like, oh, that's right. That's what I was experiencing in my classroom. Or you already figured it out. Then now I want to talk about how to work with these differences. According to Milton Bennett's developmental models of intercultural sensitivity, there are 6 levels. The first 3 is called ethnocentric, and next 3 is ethno-relative. The first level of ethnocentric intercultural sensitivity is denial. I don't think there's any other way. So maybe when you're teaching your language, you know, of course you teach the language the way you learned, and maybe you're giving the way the language teaching is done in your own country. And if you're one of the people who put 1, who rated yourself 1 in terms of cultural awareness, maybe you're teaching the way you learned. And maybe you are not aware that students have different expectations when it comes to language learning. So it happened for me too. When I first started teaching, I only taught the way I learned, which was Japanese way. And I taught Japanese as a language TA at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. But I was focusing on more Japanese way, which was like drilling more and being strict about how to write. And the writing was very important. Whereas students came from more speaking based. But at first, I didn't know. And I had to learn it in the hard way to find out that there are different ways that students prefer to do. And second level is called defense. In defense, what you think is, my way is the best. Which means you see that the other person prefers something else, but still you think your way is better or the best. So in my case, that, yeah, I understand the students like just speaking and not so much drilling and writing, but still, writing is more important and this is the best. That's the defense stage. The next one is minimization. What it means is what we have in common is much more important. So what it means is that you are not really looking at the different styles of learning or teaching, but you're looking at the same thing. So for example, in my example, I would say, yeah, there's difference between me thinking writing is important and students speaking is important, but we have something in common. We both think reading is important, so let's increase reading. So that could mean it is positive because we are focusing on something common, but it is still called minimization because you're minimizing the importance of difference. So we have to look at how different we are and respect each other. So that's why it's still in the ethnocentric developmental stage. And the next stage, which goes into ethno-relative stage, is acceptance. In this stage, you can think people's values and behaviors are different. So you can finally see it's different and you can respect the difference. And next stage is adaptation. I'm adding new behaviors to be more effective. So here, the big difference from acceptance is just not cognitively understanding what's happening, but also you can change your behavior. So maybe you will add some different activities in your teaching to respect the student's preferred style. That's the adaptation style. And the last is integration. I can move in between cultures. So depending on the student's culture, or depending on the context, depending on the goal, depending on the timing, depending on the kind of activity, you can change the way you teach. And this is where we want to get. But important thing about this developmental model is it's not fixed. It's very fluid. So depending on your physical or emotional status, where you are can change. So by class or at the stage of your life, maybe you're more closer to ethnocentric area, but then sometimes you can be ethno-relative. So if you are really physically tired coming from your country, so depending on the situation or your physical condition, usually your acceptance level, but sometimes you will fall into defense level, like, oh, I still want to do it my way because it's easier. And that's fine. But the important thing is being aware that you are doing that. And also, that could happen to the students. Now, I would like to introduce something called DIVE model. DIVE model can be used that when you are in the middle of these two different cultural dimensions, and maybe there is an iceberg crash. When these two views or two cultural dimensions clash, that you will feel some negative feeling. It can be anger, it can be frustration, it can be disappointment. Any negative feeling, that if you feel it, please be aware that your icebergs are crashing. And in order not to crash and sink like Titanic, it's really important for us to dive into the ocean and find out what's happening at the bottom. Where is crashing? What beliefs, what values are crashing or misunderstood? So first, DIVE model D, what we have to do is describe what's happening with you and the other person or you in the classroom. Please describe as neutral as possible using, please describe as objective as possible using neutral words. Just like what we did in talking about stereotypes and generalization, it's really important that you don't use judgmental words, but objective and descriptive words. Then next, what can you do is to interpret it, to find out how are you interpreting. So what kind of meaning are you adding to this situation? And that's the bottom of the iceberg part. So from your perspective, you feel this way, you understand it means this way, but at the same time, you will be aware that there is another cultural value. So it's important to interpret, or it's important to know how you're interpreting or how the other person is interpreting. So that means you're diving into the ocean and find out what's at the bottom of the iceberg. So for example, if a student keeps coming to your class late and it's repeated, and from your observation, this is the third time this week, and your interpretation is the student's priority is not coming to school, and she is being lazy or she is being disrespectful. But it's important that you become aware, oh, I am feeling negative feeling and I am interpreting the situation this way. But then stop and try to interpret from other perspective. Maybe she's having some her life problems, and maybe she is doing more part-time job than before, and maybe there's a schedule conflict. But because of her perception of the hierarchy or perception of mistake, or because she cannot communicate something negative to a teacher, maybe she hasn't been able to tell you. And from her perspective, because she respects you, she doesn't skip class, but she comes to class although she's late. So maybe there are many, many different interpretations, and it's very important to verify. So if you can talk to her and verify, that's the best way to say that you have been observing this behavior and you want to know what makes her behaving this way, so that she can explain to you the bottom of her iceberg. Then you can evaluate how you are dealing with the situation with this intercultural competence. Then you will go back to the first situation, you know. Then you can say, okay, which part you did well and which part you want to improve. Then you can handle another intercultural iceberg crash differently. So it goes back to the first D. This dive model, of course, sometimes successful, sometimes not successful, but the important part is that you are aware that some crash is happening and some uncomfortable feeling is within you, so that you can be objectively analyzed and be able to verify the other person. So I want to ask you a question. For you, what could the teaching language iceberg be like? You know, for your own iceberg when you teach languages, what does it look like? What are the values for you? And please always remember that some kind of crash will happen. So please think about one instance that you felt very uncomfortable or angry or disappointed towards either one student or a classroom. What was happening back then? Please try to describe what was happening and try to interpret. You know, how were you interpreting the situation, and how could you interpret in different way if you're looking from the Korean cultural perspective? And if you have a chance, please talk to someone and try to talk about different dimensions and verify what was the different views and evaluate. Okay, so how was your response after that? How effectively and appropriately were you able to handle the situation? And you will go back to D. So the complexity of this is that you're not the only one who has the iceberg. Of course, each learner has their iceberg. And also, to make it even more challenging, school or curriculum or leader have their own iceberg. So you're dealing with multiple icebergs. So you need to keep diving into different parts of the ocean. So you need to repeat this dive model as many times as you need. And this is what intercultural awareness and intercultural competence is. The bottom line is intercultural competence is the ability to be able to go up and down of an iceberg and also go back and forth or sideways of the iceberg, that you were able to swim across the ocean and deep into the ocean and come back. Lastly, I would like to ask you, what was the takeaway for you from this session? Which part resonated with you the most? Or what was a big discovery to you? And what did you learn about yourself? And based on these learnings, I want to ask you, how would you like to take these learnings further to move forward? So I want you to think at least one thing you would like to stop doing from now on when you're teaching. And another thing is at least one thing you would like to start doing from now on. Please think. And if you have a chance, please write it down so you can make your goal successful. I hope that this session helped you to be more aware of culture or what's happening in classroom or communication with your students. I hope that you will be able to create a safer place for both you and the students, because it is a place for transformation. Thank you so much for joining me, and I hope that you will enjoy the rest of the Cortisol 2020 conference. Good luck. Have fun.